Hello and welcome to this lecture on NMR spectroscopy or NMR spectrometry. NMR stands for nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy. It's one of several topics falling within the chapter analytical chemistry. What does a modern NMR spectrometer look like? Here's one here. In essence, we have here a very strong magnet, and within it a device which can emit electromagnetic radiation within the radio part of the electromagnetic spectrum. And our sample is placed in there in a long narrow glass tube. This is a much more old-fashioned NMR spectrometer. The actual place where the magnet is found is up here at the bottom right. And this is Tommy from the local university, who kindly shows us how the NMR spectrometer functions. You can see here the old-fashioned method of printing out a long graph page, and we would have various peaks being produced here that can be used to elucidate the structure, much of the structure of the organic molecule. Here we see the sample tube, which looks very much like this in modern machines as well, a long narrow glass tube holding the sample, and that's lowered into the center of a strong magnetic field. And then electromagnetic radiation from the radio part of the spectrum is passed through this sample, causing certain events to take place which can be interpreted to show us what kinds of hydrogen environment are present within the molecule. Let's take a quick look at a relative of NMR, and that's the MRI scanner. I remember our local hospital in the late 80s fundraising to buy one of these, because they represented a tremendous development in the early discovery of tumours, for example. You see what's common. They've also got the source for radio waves and the magnet as well. The patient goes in here, and it looks as if you can have a total body scan here, or more typically scanning the brain for tumours and that kind of thing. This is what a scan of the brain would look like. And you can see you get vivid detail right into the center of the brain. So doctors now have the ability to identify tumors that they simply couldn't even have seen 50 to 20 years ago. Tumors that would only have shown up perhaps after the person had died and a post-mortem was carried out. Now these tumors can be picked up very early, when perhaps there's time to be able to take action and do something about them. We're going to be looking specifically at what's known as proton NMR. Remember that a hydrogen atom has got one proton, one electron, and no neutrons. So a hydrogen ion is effectively just a proton. And so we refer to this as proton NMR. NMR works on atoms that have an uneven or odd number of particles in the nucleus. And that includes, most importantly, the hydrogen atom, which only has one proton. Also very popular is carbon-13 NMR, but we'll only be looking here at so-called hydrogen NMR, or better still, proton NMR. And it's used to elucidate the structure of organic molecules, and we only go up as far as molecules with six carbons. Going to take a quick look at the underlying theory here. Protons do not just simply sit in place within a nucleus. They are in fact spinning. So if you think of it spinning on its axis, a proton is identified as having two spins. You can either spin in this direction or spin in the opposite direction, one clockwise and the other counterclockwise. So they have two different spins, and when they spin, they behave like a magnet. Essentially, they behave like a bar magnet. And the two different spins represent opposing states, like so. So if we put these molecules which contain hydrogens into a magnetic field, you can understand how the protons themselves, which behave as little magnets, are going to be influenced by the magnetic field. They will line themselves up. So if we think of a magnetic field in simple terms like so, this is the north and this is the south. In a molecule, and let's take a molecule like ethanol, for example. Ethanol has a total of six hydrogens, as you see here. Now, from now on, we need to get used to using the term proton. So, six hydrogens, but it's better to say that the ethanol molecule has 6 protons. And each one of these might behave differently as a magnet. Each of these behaves like a magnet now because the proton in its nucleus is spinning and it gives it a magnetic moment. Let's consider just one of those and liken it to a bar magnet. This will typically line up in the lower energy state, which would have the south and the north there, of course, as you would expect, opposite poles attracting. But if we begin to pass radiation through this sample here, we will find that the bar magnet, which is actually the proton, that it will flip from one spin state to the other if the energy of the radiation coincides exactly to the amount of energy needed to transfer from one state to the higher energy state. And as I've said, this amount of energy is very small and happens to fall within the radio part of the spectrum. Of course, as we continue to change the energy of the radiation or the wavelength of the radiation, moments later it'll flip back to its ground state, its more stable state, once again. But it's made its mark. If there's a detector over here at this side, it will have detected that something happened there, that the energy of the electromagnetic radiation, for some reason, at that specific wavelength, didn't get through, or at least it didn't all get through. Some of it was absorbed. And that has created an event which we can then interpret. Now, the fortunate thing is that these hydrogens, which are better to refer to as protons now, if they are in a different environment, that will influence them, and they will flip with different energy. So each hydrogen in a different environment will flip at a different wavelength of radio, a different wavelength of radiation within the radio part of the spectrum. Now, in the ethanol molecule, we've already established that we have 6 hydrogens. Better to say that we have 6 protons. But actually, we only have what the chemist refers to as, we only have 3 types of proton. These 3 here, in what's called the methyl group, they are in the same environment, and they behave the same, exactly the same. They'll flip at exactly the same wavelength of electromagnetic radiation. These 2 here, the CH2 group, is known as a methylene group, methylene. They are in exactly the same environment, and they will flip at exactly the same time, but at a different electromagnetic wavelength of electromagnetic radiation to those in the methyl group. And here, this is another type of proton, the one attached to the oxygen. It too will flip, but at a different wavelength of electromagnetic radiation to both the methylene hydrogens and the methyl hydrogens. So what we'll end up getting here with this molecule is we'll get 3 events, and they'll happen at different wavelengths, and as a result we'll be able to interpret the type of hydrogen environment, or in simple terms, we'll be able to identify the 3 types of proton that are present in this molecule, and from that we will be able to elucidate the structure to a large extent of the organic molecule, specifically with regard to the type of hydrogen environments. We'll be able to say, look, there's a CH3 type environment, there's a CH2 type environment. We'll even be able to say things like, well, look, there's a C double bond H environment. Or we might be able to say, look, there's a CH3 connected to a C double bond O type environment. These all happen at predictable points, and we'll see where that happens. This slide just simply shows what I tried to show you there, the spinning of the proton creating a magnetic moment. And these spins are referred to as the plus half and the minus half, details that we do not need to know. You can see they're referred to as alpha and beta as well. But liken this to the magnet being like that in one case and being like this in the higher spin state in the other case. This shows a little bit better the spinning and the creation, therefore, of what is essentially like a little bar magnet. It spins, it generates a magnetic field. The resulting spin magnet has a magnetic moment which is proportional to its spin. In the presence of an external magnetic field, the two spin states exist, plus a half and minus half. The magnetic moment of the lower energy state is aligned with the external field, but that of the higher energy half spin state is opposed to the external field. Note that the arrow representing the external field point points north. Now, as we proceed through the slides, the remaining thing that we've got to appreciate is why hydrogens in different environments, again getting used to the jargon, why is it that protons in different locations, different environments, flip at different points? The difference in energy between the two spin states is dependent on the external magnetic field strength. Obviously, if the magnetic field strength is stronger, it's going to take more energy before it flips from this state to that state. So if we keep the magnetic field strength constant, we can scan across the radio part of the spectrum, increasing or decreasing the wavelength of the electromagnetic radiation, in other words, increasing the energy of the radiation, until we reach a point where we supply exactly the right amount of energy, energy of exactly the precise wavelength required, and we will notice then that energy is absorbed, and we know the reason why, because it's flipping from one spin state to the other. The diagram illustrates that the two spin states have the same energy when the external field is zero, but that they diverge as the field increases. At a specific magnetic field strength, a specific small quantity of energy, and it is small, it happens to fall within the radio waves part of the spectrum, is required to flip the spinning proton from the plus a half to the minus a half state. Strong magnetic fields are necessary for NMR spectroscopy. Even with these high fields, the energy difference between the two spin states is extremely tiny. And this is of significance if you were asked, why is it you need such a strong magnet? It's to do with the fact that in order to force the two states to be sufficiently different, you need to have a very strong magnetic field. The more powerful the magnetic field, then the larger the amount of energy that's required. And you can see here that even with strong magnets, it's only a tiny amount of energy. I hope you can put those two bits together. Irradiation of a sample with radio frequencies, we just use the abbreviation RF, corresponding exactly to the spin state separation, the difference between the plus a half and minus a half, of a specific set nuclei. In other words, a hydrogen in a specific environment. Is it a hydrogen in a CH3 or a CH2 or a COOH? Will cause excitation of those nuclei from the plus a half to the minus a half spin state. Energy will be absorbed, and we can pick that up as a particular event. This electromagnetic radiation falls within the radio and television broadcast spectrum. So NMR spectroscopy is therefore the energetically mildest type of probe. We look at infrared, we look at UV visible, we look at ultraviolet. Well, of all these types of spectroscopy, this is the one that uses the smallest amount of energy to make the event take place. Now, since protons all have the same magnetic moment, we might expect all hydrogen atoms to basically flip with the same amount of energy within a magnetic field, and that's not the case, fortunately. Fortunately, for chemistry applications, it isn't true. The answer to this question lies with the electrons surrounding the protons in the covalent compounds. Since electrons are charged particles, and remember, if we think in very simple terms of a CH bond, there's a pair of electrons shared between that C and the H. Now, the closer that bonding pair of electrons is to the hydrogen, we'll see the closer they are to the hydrogen, the more that pair of electrons shields that hydrogen, that proton, from the influence of the external magnetic field. It's known as shielding. But we know that carbon's more electronegative, so it's going to be pulling those electrons more strongly towards it, pulling it away from the hydrogen, reducing the shielding. Now, if carbon is attached to something that's electron withdrawing, pulling electrons from the carbon, like, for example, a benzene ring, if the carbon is attached to something that's pulling electrons from it, it's going to get even greedier for this bonding pair of electrons between it and the hydrogen. And that will pull that bonding pair of electrons away further from the hydrogen, causing that hydrogen to have lower shielding. And so this is what it's down to. The different environments, what we mean basically is that the amount of shielding of the proton, of the hydrogen, varies from one environment to the next. The pair of electrons is either closer or further from the hydrogen, affecting the shielding. And as a result of having different degrees of shielding of the protons, the wavelength of the electromagnetic radiation required to make the proton flip is going to vary. In simple terms, the more the proton is shielded, the less energy it will take to flip the molecule. It says here, since electrons are charged particles, they move in response to the external magnetic field. Forget about this bit. So as to generate a secondary field that opposes the much stronger applied field. This secondary field shields the nucleus from the applied field. Too much physics-y that. Don't worry too much about that. So the magnetic field must be increased in order to achieve resonance. Now this is looking at the opposite position here, and it is important that this is brought out. I have described a scenario where we keep the strength of the magnetic field constant, and we vary the energy of the electromagnetic radiation passed through the sample. But there's no reason why we can't do it the other way. We could pass energy through the... We could have a very strong magnetic field to begin with, and pass radiation through the sample, which is a fixed wavelength. And what we could then do is begin to weaken the magnetic field and keep weakening it and weakening it until we come to a point where at that weaker magnetic field the energy being passed through is sufficient now to make it flip. So you have two different possibilities. Either keep the magnetic field constant and vary the wavelength of the electromagnetic radiation, or do it the other way around. These are details that you'll not be tested on, but because you're here to learn chemistry, let's cover the basic facts. Now, producing an NMR spectrum, it's good to have a particular example in mind, and methanol isn't a bad example to have the back of your mind when we're talking about it. We see here, if I was to ask you the question, how many hydrogens are there in a methanol molecule, you'd say 4. If I was to say to you, how many protons are there in a methanol molecule, I hope you'll say 4 now, because these hydrogens, within the context of NMR, are better referred to as protons. If I was to ask you, how many different types of proton are there in this molecule, perhaps you're getting to a point where you can begin to recognize that while there are 4 protons, there's only 2 types of protons. These here actually have an identical environment, and if I draw that molecule out a little bit better for you, you might see that. This carbon, actually the hydrogens are located around like that. Now those, and remember, single bonds do rotate. So while one moment the OH might be like that, the next moment it's going to be over at the other side here. Like so. Anyway, these, if you were a hydrogen there, you'll be in exactly the same environment as this hydrogen, or indeed that one. And as a result, while there are 4 protons in a methanol molecule, there are only 2 types of proton. Now, shortly we'll be looking at this molecule, tetramethyl silane, TMS. It's a silicon surrounded tetrahedrally by 4 carbons, like so. And each of the carbons has got 3 hydrogens attached. In other words, in this particular molecule, we have a total of 12 hydrogens. Could you tell me how many different types of proton we have? We have 12 protons, but how many types of proton have we got? Have we 12 types of proton, or 4 types of proton? Well, in fact, we've only 1 type of proton. If you were this hydrogen, you'd be in exactly the same environment as any other hydrogen, for example, that, because of the symmetry of this molecule. These bonds around the silicon are placed tetrahedrally, and so on. Now, consider this bond SIC. Now, in this particular bond, which particular element is more electronegative? carbon and silicon are both in group 4. In fact, it goes carbon, silicon, germanium, tin and lead. And as we go down any group, electronegativity falls. Carbon, in this particular molecule, unusually, is more electronegative than the other atom attached to it, apart from hydrogens, that is. This bonding pair of electrons between the Si and the carbon, if we think of the midway point, is more towards the carbon than the silicon. Now, because this carbon here is attached to an atom that is able to pull electrons from, at least is able to make some pull on the electrons, it makes it less greedy, for example, for this pair of electrons which it's sharing with this hydrogen, with this proton. Now, in this particular scenario, this is more or less as close as the bonding pair of electrons ever gets to a proton in a molecule. I'll explain the significance of that to you momentarily again. In this particular case, carbon's attached to a silicon atom which is less electronegative than it. So in this particular bond, carbon wins out. It's able to pull on that bonding electrons between it and the silicon and get a more than fair share. As a result, it makes it a little bit less greedy for this bonding pair of electrons with the hydrogen. As a result, in this particular molecule, the bonding pair of electrons between the C and the H gets as close, well, it's not close, it's not even at the halfway point, but it gets as close as it's ever going to get, so to speak, to the hydrogen. So in this molecule here, we have the highest amount of shielding of the proton that we ever come across. And because this molecule has got 12 protons that all share the same environment, it obviously gives a very good strong signal. And this is basically where we start the scale, though the scale tends to go unusually from right to left. And TMS is basically the starting point. It's zero. And in other words, the protons, these 12 protons in TMS represent the zero point. And we compare protons in all other molecules with the protons in TMS, and we talk about them being further downfield. You can appreciate that if we're dealing with an organic molecule where the C of the H is bonded to an electron withdrawing group like benzene, that's going to be, you've got to visualize that the benzene is going to be pulling this pair of electrons here greedily towards it, and as a result it's going to make the carbon in turn greedier for this bonding pair of electrons between it and hydrogen. And in such a scenario, this type of proton is going to have much poorer shielding than in the case of TMS. So to use the jargon, such a proton, as in a molecule like this, is going to be well downfield from TMS. If on the other hand we had, let's say, a CH3 attached to a C with a H, we're going to have something that's not too different from the protons in silane. It might be, if this was in relative terms, something like 1, whereas in the case of a benzene type structure, it might be way down at 8 or 9 or something like that in relative terms. Okay, I hope that was reasonably clear. Let's just pick some of those up. To begin with, NMR spectrometer must be tuned to a specific nucleus. In our case, it's tuned to the proton. In other case, it might be the C13 nucleus. The actual procedure for obtaining the spectrum varies depending on the particular NMR spectrometer. And I've shown you there two, a modern version and an older version. In some cases, it might keep the strength of the magnetic field constant and vary the wavelength of the electromagnetic radiation. In other cases, it might do the opposite. The simplest is referred to as a continuous wave, or CW method. A typical CW spectrometer is shown in the following diagram. Again, this goes well beyond what we need to know, but does pick up a couple of important basic points for us, namely the magnet producing the magnetic field. It shows us here where the radio waves are generated. Sorry, that's the red, isn't it? The red here, you can see, that's where the radio waves are generated. And then we've got this receiver which picks up the radio waves and amplifies it. And then that's going to have to be interpreted and recorded. Basic idea. And another point is picking up is that the tube is constantly kept spinning. In a modern device, we have some kind of a device which is potentially shaped like this, and it sits within liquid nitrogen, and as the liquid nitrogen vaporizes, it causes, gets into the veins of this device, rather like sort of helicopter blades, and it makes it constantly spin as the convection currents rise up. They catch the fans or whatever of this and cause it to spin, and inside you've got your sample tube. So it is important that this is kept spinning all the time. But nothing, no more detail is needed than that. So the radio frequency radiation of appropriate energy is broadcast, technical term, broadcast into the sample from the antenna coil that you see labeled there. A receiver coil then surrounds the sample tube, and emission of absorbed radio frequency energy is monitored by dedicated electronic devices. So for most of the time, nothing unusual is happening. But when a point is reached where the wavelength of the radio waves is exactly the right wavelength to make that event take place, then clearly that's going to be picked up as some particular event having happened. An NMR spectrum is provided by varying or sweeping the magnetic field over a small range while observing the radio frequency signal from the sample. So here's the one where we keep the radio wave, the radio frequency that's being broadcast is kept fixed, and you're sweeping the magnetic. In other words, you're changing the strength of the magnetic field. And this idea of resonating, it's the point where it just comes, where the two, the strength of the magnetic field and the wavelength of the radio waves just come into the right, exactly the right point, which corresponds to the flipping from one spin state to another spin state for a particular proton. In other words, for a particular type of hydrogen environment, maybe a CH3 or a CH2 or whatever. And then we have this alternative approach, which I've mentioned several times now. I've explained to you this business of TMS, tetramethylsilane, and why it's used as the standard. It's to do with this bonding pair of bonding pair of electrons, not this one, but if we take the CH is drawn out here. In this particular case, the bonding pair of electrons gets as close to the hydrogen as it does in any molecule. And so in this particular molecule, we have the most shielding that we're going to observe. In all other organic molecules, the protons are less shielded and are downfield of TMS. And I've emphasized that the reason why is that because carbon is, in this case, more electronegative than silicon, so it gets a good pull on this pair of electrons, making it less greedy for those electrons, which means that those electrons get closer to the hydrogen than would otherwise be the case, and the protons there in TMS are well shielded. You can pause that for a moment if you want. So things you should bear in mind, recognition of the fact that these 12 hydrogens are, and this is the jargon, they're described as chemically equivalent protons or hydrogen atoms. Chemical shifts are measured then in relation to the internal reference TMS. What you'll find is that the person operating the NMR spectrometer will put the sample into that long narrow sample tube, but will also put in a few drops of TMS at the same time. And that then will, because of the large number of protons in that environment, that will give a very good strong signal, and that will represent the zero point on the scale, so to speak. As I said earlier, it goes from right to left, so the TMS signal will be there, and we'll get other signals further downfield from the other protons. So we have the TMS signal, those 12 protons, and then protons in the organic molecule that was put into the sample tube. If we have three different environments, three different types of protons, then we'll get three different peaks appearing in this graph. It says the signal for TMS is well away from most other proton absorptions. One other thing to bear in mind, or a few other things to bear in mind about the use of TMS is which also helps to explain its use, is the fact that it is that it's relatively inert and not reacting with the organic substance that it's being mixed with, and that it's non-volatile and various other things. When you look at the past paper questions, you'll see some of these points brought out. Here's a question from AQA. Draw the structure of TMS and give two reasons why it's used. Now, I would personally might have got this wrong here. The reason I would have been identifying the fact that we've got 12 equivalent protons, which means you get a strong signal. In fact, this particular paper, and different examining boards obviously will on occasions determine that different things are the right answer, but they came up with this, the fact that it's inert, the fact that it's non-toxic. Inert means it's important because it is important, it doesn't chemically react with the sample. Clearly that's important. It's non-toxicity, and the fact that it is volatile or has a low boiling point is also important. And this exam paper said that the marker should mark wrong or ignore the fact that it's cheap or that it has a single intense peak or whatever. So make sure that you're also aware of this, the importance of these things. Now we begin to talk about when we TMS then is the zero point, and we compare the protons in TMS with the protons, in other words the hydrogen atoms or hydrogen environments that we find in organic molecules. And we use this term, the shift, how far they shifted from that base point. If TMS is here, how far they shifted downfield. And this is where this comes from. And we'll see how, in the examination, you will be given tables along with your periodic table, known as chemical shifts, given in parts per million for different types of protons. And here, you can pause and study some of these chemical shifts. Here's TMS, so that's your starting point on the scale, and here we are, so to speak, moving downfield. We see that the benzene ring is well downfield because there the carbon in that particular case is going to have the electrons pulled into the delocalized ring structure there, and as a result that carbon is going to be quite greedy for that bonding pair of electrons, and that particular proton then is going to have relatively low shielding. And if it has relatively low shielding, how is that going to influence it in terms of where it flips? Well, it's going to take much more energy because it's, as a result of it being less shielded, it's more strongly influenced by the external magnetic field, and therefore it's going to take more energy, it's going to take shorter wavelength, higher energy, radio waves, to make that flip from one spin state to the other. When you get these C double bond O's as well, they tend to be electron withdrawing, and as a result you see the influence of that. In fact, it's even greater, it's even further downfield than those with the benzene ring. And chlorines are electronegative groups there. We've got the delocalized, we've got the double bond, the pi system there. And that's causing electrons, these electrons here tending to be pulled towards that electron double bond there, and the pair of electrons is being pulled further from the hydrogens, so we've got relatively low shielding and it's well downfield from TMS and so forth. This molecule here, which is very like TMS, only with a carbon where the silicon is, that is not terribly far downfield from the TMS, which is what you'd expect. But you would be given this in the form of a table, not like that, but something like this, where you're given chemical shift in parts per million. Here we see a very small shift, and that's cyclo, it's a cyclic structure, three carbons in a triangle type arrangement like that, and these are all equivalent protons because of the symmetry of this molecule. So while there are six protons, there's only one type of proton there, and here the bonding pair of electrons sits relatively close to the hydrogen, so that we've got relatively high shielding, similar to that found in TMS, so it's not very far downfield, 0.2 parts per million. But the ones that you need will be provided in the examination. Here's a more comprehensive list. Now we're going to take a look at another aspect. When we look at these peaks, we find that the peaks sometimes are split. So instead of just getting the particular peak for TMS, and let's say if we take a specific example, methanol, let me try to draw methanol here for you. Methanol has four protons, but it has only got two types of proton, this one and then this one, or these. So you've got the so-called methyl protons, three in number, and then you have the hydroxyl proton there as well. Four protons, but just two types of proton. So you may visualize in simple terms the TMS peak and then two other peaks. But in fact, it's not as simple as that. We find that some of these peaks are split. And here we see a peak which isn't split, and the term for a peak that isn't split is a singlet. Singlet. Once the peak is split into a number, these are what are known as multiplets, and you get various multiplets like the doublet, triplet, and quartet. Here we see a peak has been split into two. The heights of the two peaks are the same, so the ratio is 1:1. Here we see a peak being split into three, known as a triplet, and the ratio is 1:3:1. Sorry, 1:2:1 here, so that's one in terms of the relative heights, 1:2:1. In other words, this peak is twice the heights of the others. And then we have the so-called quartet, where the peak is split into four, and this is in the ratio 1:3:3:1. And we'll not go into the details of why this comes up. Now, why does splitting like this happen? It's caused a result of something known as spin-spin interactions. It's where the spinning of protons in one environment interact with those adjacent, in other words, protons on an adjacent carbon, and we'll see how a rule called the N plus 1 rule is used to reason how many peaks a particular peak will be split into, whether it's a doublet, triplet, quartet, or even more. This is just your spin, this is your spin-spin splitting here. You're getting a singlet, and the heights of the peaks then are shown here as well. If it's split into a doublet, the ratio of the heights is 1:1. In other words, in a doublet, the two peaks are the same height. With a triplet, the ratio is 1:2:1. With a quartet, it's 1:3:3:1, as I showed, and these we'll not be considering. Low and high resolution spectra. What the low resolution spectrum provides then, it'll just simply give peaks that are not split. And sometimes this is just helpful enough. What we can do is we can use the area under the peaks. Or better still, what we can do is we can integrate these peaks, in other words, use mathematical integration to convert the area to a line, and then the heights of the lines can be used more straightforwardly. The area under the peak, or if we integrate it, the heights of the relative heights of the lines, or the relative areas under the peak, indicate the relative number of protons. So if the area under this is 1 relative to 2 to 3, in this simple type, this so-called low-resolution NMR, what it does tell us is the number of protons present. So we get two bits of information from this particular NMR. It tells us, first of all, there are three types of protons. Why? Because we got three peaks. As long as one of them isn't TMS, this is three separate peaks. So it tells us there are three different environments. So for example, if you take ethanol, ethanol looks like that. And in ethanol, there are indeed six protons, six hydrogens, or to use the correct jargon, there are six protons there. How many different types of proton can you see there? Hopefully you can see there are three types. There's the methyl protons, the methylene protons of the CH2, and there's the hydrogen proton of the hydroxyl group, three different protons. Now, there is a functional group isomer of that has exactly the same numbers of carbons, hydrogens, and oxygen. It's an ether, and it looks like this. Again, you see it has got 6 protons. But can you tell me how many types of proton that molecule has? Look at the symmetry of the molecule. All 6 protons actually share the same type of environment. There's only one type of proton there. So it would be very easy to spot the difference between these two molecules using low resolution NMR, because the ether, so-called methoxymethane, will have only one peak, a tall peak. Whereas if it's ethanol that you have, you're going to get 3 separate peaks because you have 3 types of proton. So low resolution NMR may give enough information. It says here the number of peaks tells you the number of different environments, the number of different, the how many types of proton you have, to use the jargon. Secondly, the ratio of the area under the peaks tells you the ratio of the number of hydrogen atoms in each of these environments. So if you go back to ethanol here, for example, you'll get 3 peaks, and the area under the 3 peaks will be in the ratio 3:2:1. And thirdly, then, the chemical shifts give you important information. So if you had a table of chemical shifts, you will know where a methyl proton should produce a peak when it's attached to a CH2 group. You will be able to find out where a CH2 type proton gives a peak when it's attached to a methyl group, and so forth. Here's an example of an NMR spectrum. There are 3, and this is low resolution. We see no splitting of these peaks, so it's low resolution. There are 3 peaks showing 3 different hydrogen environments. 1, 2, 3. The relative areas, like in ethanol, are 1:2:3. That eliminates methyl ethanoate as a possibility, so I'm not sure where we're picking that up from, but if we look at methyl ethanoate, and see what that looks like. Methyl ethanoate, so it's based on ethanoic acid. And this methyl's got a methyl group down here. Now, its molecular form, it's got 2 carbons. It's got 3 and 3, 6 hydrogens. And it's got 2 oxygens. That's its formula, molecular formula. But there are isomers of that. I could, for example, have this. This is also an ester. It's got exactly the same molecular formula. I got those carbons wrong, didn't I? C, there's 1, 2, 3 carbons there, so I should have had C3H6O2. Sorry about that. This has also got 6 hydrogens, 3 carbons, so it's got exactly the same molecular formula. Now, each of them has, how many protons has each got? The answer is 6. How many hydrogen environments, how many types of proton do you have in each of these? Count the number of hydrogen environments in this molecule, please. Hopefully you can see this is one type of proton, and this is the other type. They're both methyl groups, but because of the lack of symmetry in this molecule, while they're both CH3s, they are different types of proton. The environment that this hydrogen or proton is in is not exactly the same as this one, so they will produce separate peaks. But this particular ester here, which is known as methyl ethanoate, will produce 2 peaks. What about this one? Again, there are, in terms of the number of protons, the answer is 6, but how many types of proton? There's 1. There's the so-called methylene protons, and there's the methyl proteins. Protons. So there are 3 types of proton there in this one, which is called ethyl methanoate. So if we didn't know whether it was which ester it was from this particular molecular formula, if we looked at the low, and we're emphasizing low as opposed to high, low resolution NMR, where we have no spin-spin splitting showing up, it would be sufficient to distinguish between these two, because one would have 2 peaks and the other would have 3. Would the ratio under the peaks help? That would also provide information, because these would produce peaks of with the same area under them, because in each particular case we have 3 protons, so the ratio would be 1:1. Now we can see how this matches up with this, because not only because there are three peaks corresponding to the three protons, but in terms of the ratio, we have one proton in this environment, two in that, and three in that, which matches up with the area under the graph, 1 to 2 to 3. Okay, so we've got that. I think we've exploited that all well enough. Now we need to look at chemical shifts. Not all of this has come out here. Because some of the writing hasn't come out, some of the preparations I made, I just realized it is worth, from the point of view of organic chemistry and for the fullness of this, to explain that there is actually a third structural isomer of this, because we could have had a carboxylic acid. We could also have had there with three carbons propanoic acid, you may find as well, and that would have been worth considering too. But moving on here, you can see here just about maybe some of these figures, but protons, this is a proton, and it's in a particular environment with the COO there, and it should give a chemical shift in this range. This type of proton, which is well away from this electronegative type group, has got relatively high shielding, which is reflected in a small chemical shift value. Look at this H, which is directly attached to the oxygen. That's well downfield, 11.0, which means the oxygen is very greedy in terms of the OH bonding pair of electrons, and we have, in relative terms, very low shielding of the proton when it's connected directly to the O. This CH2 here, which is connected to the C with a double bond O, hasn't got such a big shift. But we'll pick up the details of this through the use of examples. Again, I apologize that some of the information has simply not come out in the production of these slides as part of the Snapcast software. And what I'm doing here is, this is here propanoic acid. If we draw it out more fully, three carbons, double bond O, OH. So here you'll see that we have six protons. How many types of proton have we got? Well, we've got this, we've got the methylene protons, and we've got the methyl protons, which would explain why we've got three peaks in the low resolution NMR. It would also explain the ratio 1 to 2 to 3. Now, as you get more practice with chemical shifts, you'll begin to appreciate, if you're asked, well, which peak represents which type of proton. And you saw a moment ago how the H, when it's attached to the O, has very low shielding and is way downfield. So that's what would enable you to link up the fact that this is the OH. As well, in this case, it's very clear, because the OH being one of a kind, as compared to the methylene proteins, where the methyl protons where you have three of a kind, or the methylene proteins where you have protons where you have two of a kind, the area also helps. But in terms of chemical shift, you do expect the peak for the OH to be way downfield with a large chemical shift. Which would it be? Would it be the methylene protons or the methyl protons that would be furthest downfield? Well, because the methylene protons are nearest to this electronegative group, it shouldn't surprise you that they're here, somewhere between the other two. Okay, so that's low resolution. We're looking now at high resolution NMR, where it picks up on the spin-spin splitting, and we have to learn how to interpret the significance of these singlets, doublets, triplets, quartets, and we'll be applying the so-called N+1 rule. So here, many of what looked like single peaks in low resolution spectroscopy are now split and produce clusters of peaks. For A-level purposes, you'll need to consider these possibilities only, where you get one peak known as a singlet, where the peak is split into two, known as a doublet, split into three, known as a triplet, split into four, known as a quartet. You can get exactly the same information from a high-resolution spectrum as from a low-resolution spectrum. You simply treat each cluster of peaks as if it were a single one in a low resolution spectrum. But in addition, the amount of splitting of the peaks gives you important extra information about adjacent protons. So this is where we begin to connect, right, there's a CH3 there, but it must be next to a CH2, or look, there's a CH3 there, but it must be, according to the splitting pattern, it must not be next to a carbon with hydrogens, because it's not being split. We'll see how the spin-spin splitting, or the lack of it, gives us more information. So interpreting high resolution spectrum and applying the so-called N+1 rule. The amount of splitting tells you about the number of hydrogen atoms attached to the carbon atom, or atoms, next door. So, but by that I mean, if I have a CH3, there's a CH3 present in, for example, ethanol. Now, the peak that is produced for the methyl protons here, it is split because of the fact, and we follow what it says here, the amount of splitting tells you about the number of hydrogen atoms attached to the carbon atom or atoms next door to the one that you're currently interested in. So if we're looking at the peak for the CH3 protons, and we find that that peak is split, the way in which it's split is determined by the number of protons attached to carbons which are on either side of that. Now in this particular case there's no carbon bonded to the left of it. We have this carbon bonded to the right of it, and it has two protons on it. And this is where we use this N+1 rule. Because the carbon that's attached to it has two protons, it splits the peak for this into three, into a triplet. Why? If we apply the N+1 rule, the carbon here has two hydrogens, two protons, and we go 2 + 1 = 3, and it splits it into a triplet. Now what about this particular, if we were to think then about the methylene, the peak for the methylene protons, how would it be split by the influence of the methyl group on its left and the hydrogen on its right? Well, because this carbon here is attached to a carbon that has three hydrogens on it, we apply the rule N+1, 3+1, that would split the peak for the methylene protons into 3+1, 4, into a quartet. Question is, will this hydrogen further split it as well? And in this particular case where we have an OH bond, although that's close enough to split, it doesn't split it, and the reason is this: that OH bond is constantly breaking and forming, and the hydrogen in moving in and out apparently doesn't stay around long enough to cause the splitting action. So it doesn't, this hydrogen, although it's a proton and it's relatively adjacent to the methylene protons, it does not cause any spin-spin splitting. So the only splitting in the case of the methylene group here in this particular molecule, in this particular environment, it's split by the three hydrogens of the methyl protons to the left here, and it's split therefore into 3+1 into four peaks, and it gives a quartet. If you get a singlet, that's informative. That tells you that you must have a hydrogen which is attached, which in terms of what's next door, that there are no hydrogens attached to the atoms next door to it. A doublet, that tells you that hydrogen or hydrogen next door to the CH group that you do have, that there's one hydrogen attached there. So if we come across some examples in a moment of this, but if we find that we get a doublet, that particular proton must be on a carbon where that carbon is, in terms of what it's attached to, it must be attached to a carbon that has one hydrogen attached to it. In the case of a triplet, if your peak is split into a triplet, it tells you that it has a CH2 group next door, that the carbon holding that hydrogen, that proton or protons that you're looking at, they're attached to a carbon which itself is attached to a carbon with two hydrogens on it. So it's telling you there's a CH2 next to it, attached to it. If you get a quartet for a particular proton or group of protons, it tells you that they're next door to a CH3 group. it's harder learning it from this than from actual examples. So if this is a little confusing, I'm not surprised. Just wait till you see how these are applied and you'll learn better from examples. So using this N plus 1 rule, what information can you tell from this NMR spectrum? Assume that you know that the compound has this molecular formula. And once you see C4H8, in other words, twice as many hydrogens as carbons in O2, you're thinking ester or carboxylic acid. Now it says this allows various carboxylic acid and ester alternatives, so we'll just put up one of them here so that you can see the idea. Here's an ester alternative, ethyl ethanoate, which you're familiar with. And we'll check to see whether this could possibly fit the picture. How many protons are there present? 8. How many types of proton are there present? 3. There's the methyl there, and there's a methyl at the other end, and then there's the methylene. So there are 3 types of protons. Well, so far this could actually fit, could be ethyl ethanoate. Let's look at it as a separate possibility. Here's another one. That's an isomer of that. The one I've just drawn here would be called methyl propanoate, whereas the other one was ethyl ethanoate. It has obviously the same number of protons, 8, but does it have the same number of different types of protons? The answer is yes, it does indeed. It's got a methyl, a methylene, and a methyl. The locations are slightly different though. You can see that the methylene CH2 is attached directly to the O there, whereas here it's not, it's attached to the COO, and that will make a difference. The chemical shift will occur at a different location, or the peak will appear at a different chemical shift, I should say. And there's other possibilities. We could also have this, we could have H, C, double bond O, O, CH2, CH2, CH3. It's another possibility. Now right away we see that couldn't be the case, because hopefully you can spot that there are indeed 4 different types of proton in that molecule called propyl methanoate, and that's ruled out. We could have a carboxylic acid too, which looks like this. Again, that has got 4 different types of proton. It has 8 protons but 4 types of proton, so propanoic acid is also ruled out. And we could have some chain isomerism there where that CH3 group replaces that H, so I haven't exploited all the possibilities, of course, there. But I've ruled these in for the moment. They are possibilities because they have 3 types of proton and we have 3 types of peak. Now let's go on to the next page to see how we can begin to elucidate the significance of the singlet, which the 3 in terms of the relative height of the peak, 3, this tells us that we have 3 protons in this particular environment causing this particular peak at this particular chemical shift, with 3 here and only 2 there. So this is a CH3, this is a CH3, this is a CH2. Now both of these molecules here still fit this pattern, because we do indeed have 3 in 3 different types of proton. We do indeed have 2 CH3s and we have a CH2, so both are still ruled in. So at this point we'd have to go looking at the chemical shift values to distinguish between the methylene which is attached to the O and the methylene which is attached to the COO. So here you have various carboxylic acids. 4 environments is ruled out, 3 is ruled in, 3 is ruled in, 4 is ruled out, the examples I gave you there. And we've got the 2-3-3 split. So we're going to have to turn now to chemical shifts to distinguish between this one and this one. Indeed, these may be extra examples here, but anyway, you can see on this example now we can begin to make some interpretations here. These hydrogens are on one carbon that is not directly attached to a carbon holding a hydrogen atom. So this is going to, there will be no splitting here of this. So we should have a CH3 that is no splitting. So indeed, we haven't had to turn to the chemical shifts. We can take a look at the spin-spin splitting, whether peaks are split or not. So this will give us a CH3, which will be a singlet in this particular case, because these protons are on a carbon that is not attached next door to a carbon that has any hydrogen that would cause spin-spin splitting. This CH3, there are three protons there, and that's adjacent to a CH2 group. You have two protons there, so you use the N plus 1 rule, N plus 1, 2 plus 1 is 3. This should cause a triplet. So we're looking for a triplet, which in terms of the number of protons has 3. We're looking for a singlet, which in terms of numbers of protons we have 3. And then this methylene group here has the CH3 group next door, 3 plus 1 is 4. That's going to give us a quartet with two protons present. Now if we go back here, can you see present in some of these molecules what corresponds to that? Which molecule has got a CH3 which isn't split, because it has that arrangement? At the same time, it's got, in relative terms, two protons present here that are split into a quartet. And it has three protons, because of the adjacent CH2, that are split, three protons that are split into a triplet. So which of these molecules fits that? Well, this doesn't. It doesn't have the CH3 attached. This one, I think you'll see, does. It's got the CH3 that won't be split. So this will be a singlet. And it will have, in relative terms, the number of protons, it'll have 3. We've got the methylene group, which will be split into a quartet with two protons, and we've got the CH3 there, which will be split into a triplet by the adjacent CH2 protons, and in terms of the numbers of protons, there are 3 protons in that environment. Again, through more and more examples, these should become clearer to you. So the lack of splitting, that can show up the presence of an OH group. Unless the alcohol is absolutely free of any water, the hydrogen on the OH group and any hydrogens on the next door carbon don't interact to produce any splitting. Again, another argument I've seen in the literature is the fact that this OH bond is breaking and forming, and even if it's attached to a carbon with hydrogens, like in the case of ethanol, this does not cause any spin-spin splitting with the CH2 group, nor indeed does the CH2 group here cause any splitting with regard to the proton of the OH. So the OH peak always shows up as a singlet, and you don't have to worry about the effect on any next door hydrogens. I'm not going to look at this. We'll just move on to some relatively straightforward examples. So these are all high resolution spectra that are coming up here for organic molecules. So here's butane. Does this make sense to you? Can you see that there are, how many different protons are there in this? I say different. How many different protons are there? How many different hydrogen environments are there? And I would warn you about the symmetry of this molecule here. You can see, in fact, there are two peaks, and that tells you there are just two environments. Hopefully you can see that this CH3, and indeed the other CH3 at the other end, those are all in the same environment. So there are 6 protons that share that environment. And then I hope that you can see that this CH2 and this CH2, that they're identical in terms of environment. So there are 4 in that environment, and the ratio of peaks is 6 to 4. here's chloroethane. How many protons? There are 5 protons here. How many types of proton? Peaks give it away. There are 2 types of proton. What are they? There's the so-called methyl protons and the so-called methylene protons, the CH2 here. Why is this the in relative terms it's 3 to 2? Can you tell why the 2 representing the methylene protons? Why is the chemical shift for the methylene protons further downfield than for the CH3? Well, the CCl bond here, this is a polar bond. Chlorine's more electronegative, it'll tend to pull that bonding pair of electrons, and it'll make this carbon greedier for the bonding pairs of electrons with the hydrogens. So these hydrogens will be less shielded, and that's why they're further downfield. Bromopropane, something similar, a bit longer. We've got 7 protons. How many types of protons given away by 1, 2, 3? Can I just go back to see if I missed some spin-spin splitting there? I should have picked up on the spin-spin splitting. The methylene protons there, CH2, would be split by the 3 protons on the methyl. N plus 1, 3 plus 1 is 4. So they should be split, whether you can see it or not, they should be split into a quartet. And in terms of the CH3 protons represented by this peak to the right here, because they are attached to the methylene group with 2 protons, they should have been split into 2 plus 1 into 3 peaks, a triplet. So you're supposed to see a triplet here and a quartet there. Looking again at bromopropane, 1 bromopropane, we've got, hopefully you can see, we have 7 protons, but we have 3 types of proton there. Raise those marks for a moment. Now, we have 2 methylenes, CH2 here, but they are different environments because of that bromine at the end that's electronegative. These will be have less shielding than those because they're right adjacent to this electronegative bromine, which will pull on the electrons from that carbon, making this carbon greedier for these protons here. So that should be that group. That should match up with that. In terms of its splitting, it's adjacent to the CH2. Now this group here is too far away. It has to be on the next door carbon. The next door carbon is this one, and it has 2 hydrogens on it, so this should be split into a triplet. Hopefully that's showing up as a triplet. Now if we go to this group here, it's a bit simpler to deal with. First, the CH3, this is it. CH3 is furthest away from the electronegative bromine, so here we've got the most shielding of the 3 types of proton present, and that will be split by the adjacent CH2. It'll be split into 2 plus 1 into a triplet, so this should be showing up as a triplet here as well. And this, because it is adjacent protons on both sides, goes beyond what we need to do. I'm not going to take a look at the splitting there. Ethanol is next. There are 6 protons, but how many types of protons? 1, 2, the methylene protons and the methyl protons corresponds to 1, 2, 3. You notice here, and this may surprise you, that the hydrogen directly attached to the O isn't the furthest downfield. In fact, it's these protons here that are furthest downfield. This CH2 group is this peak furthest downfield. This is this one, which is clearly shows up with the relative numbers of protons. There's only 1 proton there. It's a singlet. Remember how the OH is neither split. The proton of the OH is neither split, nor does it cause splitting in the next door hydrogens either. If we look at this CH3, it's furthest from the OH, so it is. It's 3 protons, which is what we see there. Because the next door carbon has 2 hydrogens, it'll be split into 2 plus 1 into 3 peaks, so this is a triplet here. In terms of this CH2, it's not affected by the H of the OH for reasons we described, but the next door carbon has three hydrogens, N plus 1, 3 plus 1 is 4. We should be seeing a quartet showing up here. Do try to remember that the CH2 is further downfield. It's got a greater chemical shift than the H, even though it's directly attached to the O. This is proton 1-all. How many protons? We've got 8 protons here. 3 and 3, 6, 7, 8. How many types of proton? There's no symmetry. Always look for symmetry in case there's symmetry in the molecule. We've got the methyl protons. We've got methyl protons here and methyl protons here. So we have 4 types of protons, which corresponds to 4 different peaks. In terms of splitting, this will not be split, nor will it cause splitting of the protons in this CH2. The relative numbers, we've got 3 protons, 2 protons, 2 protons, and 1. And that should show up as 3, 2, 2, and 1. There's no question then that this proton is causing this peak. We saw how the CH2 directly attached to the O has the biggest chemical shift, so that matches that. The one that's furthest from that is the CH3, which corresponds to that. So this is the CH3 part. We've identified now what group, what proton is causing each peak. Let's see if we can understand the splitting. And the CH3 is attached to a CH2, so that's split into a triplet. 2 plus 1 is 3. And so on, and it gets, once it goes to splitting beyond a quartet, that's beyond what we need to know, so we'll not look at that any further. Proton 2-all is a position isomer of the previous one. We've got the OH now on the middle carbon. We still have 8 protons, but how many types of protons have we got? We've got that CH3. Now what about these? There's a CH3 here, but it looks to me like these are identical in terms of the symmetry of this molecule. So those, there's 6 protons there in total from those two CH3s, but because of the relative symmetry of these molecules, those are an identical environment, which is in tune here with the, or in fitting with the 6 hydrogens. There's another hydrogen environment, and there's another. So there are 3. There's these 6 protons. There's this, there are, we have this proton which will not be split, so that has to be that one. And this H here corresponds to that H. Not bother looking at the splitting there. Propanol, we have a total here of 6 protons. How many types of protons? 1, 2, and 3. Now we're getting, nearly didn't see it here, we've got a peak way, way downfield there. And then we've got this and this. And you can see this, when we have a hydrogen that's in an aldehyde setting, the chemical shift is very, very big indeed. Further down than in the case of the CH2 that's attached to the C double bond O. And then we have the CH3 here, typically not shifted very much from TMS. Again, we could look at the spin-spin splitting. This will be split into a triplet because of the next door CH2 group. So this should be a triplet. Okay, we'll leave that. I think that's sufficient. CH2 we might have identified was split as well, but I think we've got enough information from that. Propanone, how many types of proton? We did look at this as an example much earlier on. Because of the symmetry of this molecule, we've only got, while we have 6 protons, we've only one type of proton, which is what's showing up here. One peak. Chemical shift is relatively small, 2 parts per million. Propanamine, so this has got the amine group. How How many types of proton? Well, those would be the same relative environments, so that's one. Then we've got this one here, we've got this one here, we've got this one here. So here we have got four different types of proton. And we could go and we could look up the chemical shifts and see where the NH2 protons are expected to occur and so forth. There's a degree of almost merging here of two of them. In terms of the relative numbers, three, so that's definitely our CH3 group. And we could use the chemical shift values to work out which is which thereafter. But again, this goes slightly beyond what we tend to do. Ethanoic acid, it's got this proton and the CH3. In terms of the fact that that's a one proton and that's a three, we can clearly see that matches that and that matches that. No splitting in this case. Remember, the H attached to the O isn't split and doesn't cause any splitting. So singlets in that case. Ethanoyl chloride, we've only got one type of proton here. That's it there. But it shifted downfield more than we've seen CH3s, way down at 2.5 or thereabouts. And that's attached to this group, which is probably electron withdrawing on that carbon, causing the carbon to pull on those pairs of electrons more strongly, reducing the shielding and pushing the peak further downfield. The ester, well, we've come across plenty of examples of the esters there. How many types of proton? The CH3 there and the CH3. They're both CH3s, but they're different environments. So three protons there, three there. There'll be no splitting of this. This will be a singlet because the next door carbon is no hydrogen. So that's definitely, that one definitely is that. Then that has to be the other one with the splitting. And then that is the CH2. That should be split because of this adjacent methyl group should be split here into a 3 plus 1 into a quartet. This, which is the peak here, is split into a triplet because it's connected next door to the CH2. Two protons, 2 plus 1 is 3, split into a triplet. And to finish off with, we'll look at some benzene examples. But again, this goes beyond, so you can see if it's possible for you to interpret what's going on here, the different types of protons. It's showing up 5 and 3. And like you, I'm just having to try and elucidate how many environments there are. It's telling me there are, in this particular case, there's just two different proton environments. So it's telling me that this is one proton environment, and these all, which surprises me a little bit, are all the same environment. If this was a more electronegative group like COOH, then we would be distinguishing between these as different proton environments, but not so in this particular case. After all, this is not an electronegative group. So that only in this particular case we see there's just two types of proton. Now here we get a more complicated example. Because of the presence of that C double bond O, it has created a different setup. We've got one proton here, which would be that one, and then we've two and three. Those, that would be the two, and then presumably these three down here represent this peak here. And that completes this lecture, which goes in places well beyond what you need to know for your A-level examinations. It's been taught more from the point of view of giving you a good understanding of what is an important technique. And I'd advise you now to go on and look at the other Snapcast that runs for about an hour, looking at past paper questions from a range of different examining boards. Thanks for listening.